kingdom influencers this morning, I'm sharing with you a message titled, God is a Good God. Amen. You see, the thought, if that's all that I know, it's even sufficient enough for me. Amen. God is a good God. Say to your neighbor, God is a good God. God is a good God. You know, last night we had a family who visited my home, and we got talking. And the gentleman with whom I was sharing, you know, chose to play the devil's advocate, like he said. Then asked me a question. Said, Pastor, I just want to know, why is it that sometimes you have to pray really, really, really hard for some things to come up before the shore? And I'm going to take that home this morning with the testimony of my wife, Obiche. I know how much she wanted the job. And I know the effect, the job that she was doing, which was a fantastic job, by the way, that she was doing before. I know how much she desperately wanted to. I know what I faced when I pick up after service. I know how tempting, I know how difficult it was. We're thankful for that job. God has blessed us, our family, through that job, but there was much more. I don't know how many of you can remember, we had a particular midweek service return. What she asked, the same question that I just raised, why did I have to labor? I think Sister Chidima was at that particular retreat. And I did say that the question you just raised was answered in the Sunday service while I ministered. I know some of you are also like that here. When you feel, when it comes to your own situation of life, things are always difficult. When you feel, why do I have to always pray so hard before I get the things that I want? When you feel sometimes that God does not even exist anymore. But you see, in all of all these things, we are still more than a conqueror through Him who loves us. Amen. God, there is nothing that can change that fact. If you trust the Lord today for a Mercedes Benz C-Class, if God gives it to you, He remains God. If He chooses not to bless you with it, He remains God. Your testimony or your miracles wouldn't change God from who He is. God is a good God. He's a good God, and He's always in a good mood. Did you hear me this morning? God is always in a good mood. There is no bad mood in Him. If you are the one who experiences, what do they call it? God bless you, ma'am, doctor. You are the one who experiences mood swings. The same some of you will come to church in the morning, and I'll look and say, why is this sister looking like this morning? Let me say, Pastor, good morning. You will know that day, you know, maybe she woke up, or he or she woke up on this side of the bed and not this side of the bed. But you see, in the Christendom, there is no such thing as mood swing. Every day is a day of joy. Every day is a day of thanksgiving. Every day is a day of victory. Every day of our lives. God is a good God. In that John, give me John chapter number 15. And I'm going to read verses number 5. Let's even start from verse number 4. John chapter number 15. I'm going to read from verse number 4. Let's take 4 to 9, or 4 to 8 even. Abide in me, and I in you. That's what I'm doing this morning. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, unless it abides in the vine, neither can you, unless you abide in me. Give me the next verse. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. Now, I want you to take note of the word much. Amen. I need you to take note of the word much. This person just wouldn't bear fruit, but would bear much fruit, right? Now, for without me, you can do nothing. This was Jesus speaking to his disciples. Give me the next verse. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. Verse 7. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, 2 weeks, Now, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. Amen. It's somebody in God's presence. If you abide in me, number one, and I abide in you, number two, and my word also abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. In other words, Jesus here was giving us two platforms or two pedestals to receiving anything from him. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. So it requires that for you to get the things that you desire, because what leads a man to say that God is not a good God would be because the person felt disappointed by God. Maybe he or she has an ailing mother who is on the sick bed, maybe struck with cancer, and this person is praying that God heals the mother, and God chooses to take the mother home. That such a person begins to question if God is good. But you see, Christianity has also been made to become transactionary. I mean, the gospel of Christ has been made to become transactionary by most churches and most preachers. What do I mean by that? We've been taught, or many have been trained to believe in God or to worship God because of their requests, because of their needs. I have always said to us in this church, we don't worship God because we want to receive from him. We worship him because that is who we are and because that is what we created for. Amen. So you don't worship God because you want him to bless you. No. Everything that you need to become the totality of what God has destined you to be, he has already given them to you. Very soon, some years down the line, you're going to marry. You're going to have children. You're going to buy a car of yours. The point when you're getting those things were not the first time that you've been presented with those things. Those things have already been given to you. Don't forget, it became poor that you, through his poverty, you may become rich. So in the Christendom, when we receive a thing, the physical manifestation is what you're actually expecting. But for spiritual manifestation of the things, everything they've already been given to you. So the gospel has been made to become transactionary. So you see someone who is worshiping God because he or she is desperate for a child. Now, it is not a bad thing for your need to lead you to God. But your need is not the reason why you should remain in God. Amen? It is not bad if you have a need in your life and that need leads you to God. But it becomes an issue if that need, you know, becomes the reason why you've chosen to remain in God. That is the reason why many people scream that God is good. Jesus loves me when you go in is very good. And when you pray for that job and you didn't get it, you begin to question, is it indeed good? Let's even forget about him being good. Does God even exist? Tell me you've not questioned that before. This is my wife. I'm also a pastor. So I share the word, she hears the word. Yet when she was going through that transitioning moment, the devil still attempted, you know, to still strike her, to still cause her to shut her mouth. But I kept on encouraging. I think it was the same midweek service that she asked, that same midweek service that we had, that I did say to her and everyone in that particular service, I said, most of the things you're trusting God for right now, that you see that still God is not giving to you, it's actually for your own good. Because when God chooses, when God eventually gives you that which you desire, you would realize that it is because of his mercy that you've not gotten it so far. You see, do you know God does not come late? The job she has right now is not late. The devil might have made you to see that way, but it is not late. She might have delayed it by some, you know, actions or attitudes of ours, but it's not late. Bible says that a day in God's sight, it's like 1,000 years. Or 1,000 years is like a day. Everything is given. You know, I tell you all each and every time. If your motive for wanting the thing that you desire is right. And if that which you desire is good for you, God desires to give you that desire much more than you desire to have the desire. Two things you need to question. The motive. Think about that need. You want to make a first class to the, like we'll call them back home in Nigeria, I don't know what it's called, Jambitos. Right? You want to make first class? Why should you want to make first class? To brag? To boast? Or to be able to declare to people that Jesus is indeed Lord? If your motive is right, and if that is good for you, God desires to give it to you. Bible says that you will not withhold any good thing. You know what withhold any good thing? Any good thing means any good thing. He will not withhold any good thing from those who love him. He will not withhold anything. So stop thinking or stop feeling that God is punishing you. Or stop thinking and stop feeling that God is not interested in your affairs. Stop thinking and stop feeling that you've been abandoned. The book of Lamentations says to us, Lamentations chapter number 3, I believe, Bible says that God does not cast off anyone forever. He doesn't cast off anyone forever. Let me let you know this morning. You see, this that you have on the screen, God is a good God. The moment the devil causes you to have a contrary opinion as to this, he has captured you. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. The moment the devil is able to change your psyche or to work on you, to making you think or imagine or even believe that God is not a good God, he has captured you. He's a good God. But that which you want him to do, why do you want him to do it? You know my wife's testimony. When she would go for jobs, she wasn't getting it. As a matter of fact, she would apply for internal position. It was so serious for her such that she was willing to take a pay cut just to be able to get off where she was. Pray, I'll declare, I'll do everything that I can do. Yet, by the time they get back to her, they'll tell her, oh, you did so well, you did this one, oh, you did that one, but we are sorry, we're going with another candidate. I've been there, and I've done that. I've told you before how I prayed so much for a particular job, went for the interview, and I went for the feedback because I didn't get the interview, and they told me, oh, you're so amazing. You're definitely HR is so deep, you're so fantastic. Say that you have private sector consulting experience and not government sector consulting experience. So because of that, we decided to go with someone else. And I got into my car, turned on the radio. Joel Osteen was ministry. And I heard him say, if you are walking in Jesus, in the Lord, everything that you need for now, right now as you listen to me, God has already given them to you. If there is anything you don't have right now, you don't need them. That's why you don't have them. So I began to question God, I began to query God. Okay, so I confessed, I declared, I prayed, I fasted. I think I even sowed a seed. I also sowed a seed. Because I wanted a job. This was the kind of job where when they tell you your salary, you will not even be moved to negotiate it. I said, so I told God, I said, so where's the place of grace? What was I supposed to do that I did not do? And the Lord said to me, by the time I'm done with you, you would realize that the same grace that you think is not at work in your life is the same reason why I've kept you from getting this job. Listen to me very carefully this morning, Kingdom Influences. Grace doesn't just open doors. Grace also sometimes shuts doors. I didn't get that. Did you hear me? Grace doesn't just open doors. Grace also sometimes shuts doors. That door of that job was shut against me because of grace. It wasn't up to maybe 2 months or a month afterward, that I got this one that I'm on right now. What I wanted to kill myself over was nothing compared to what God has done for me. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. So grace just doesn't get, when we're praying and we're talking about grace, many of us usually think grace means that everything should just be going smooth, everything should just be fine, there should be no loss, there should be no nothing, that you should, you know, submit a project and you should be accepted, you should go for, you should drop your proposal and you should just be stamping it, you should make a request and your request should just be granted. Yes, that's grace. But should I shock you again? Grace does much more than that. Grace just does not open door. Grace also sometimes shuts doors. So many of the things that many of you are lamenting about that has made you to think that God is no longer a good God, what shut those doors were shut because of His grace. But you will not understand the depth of shutting of those doors right now until God takes you into your own kingdom. You see, there is a part of our testimony that she didn't tell you. When my wife, you know, when we got home that day, we drove into the carriage. And then she was just jumping all over me. She was laughing. I said, what's going on? Why are you just dancing around in the carriage? So I said, you got an offer. Because I know how much that has helped. When she opened a laptop to me in the bedroom to show me the offer letter, when I saw the package, see, God is a good God. Let me borrow the message of Joel Austin again. Brother Tommy, if there is anything that you desire, if you don't have it yet, God is still a good God. All that you need in life, if you are in the will of the Lord, God has already given that to you. Those jobs you wanted to kill herself over, this was the same person. Your current pay from the previous one must have been like 80, 70% increase. Now you some of you don't understand. I'm just trying to give you an idea. My 80 to 70% increase in multinational. This same person who is struggling with one other local bank here that called out for interview and they didn't give her the job. God. You see, kingdom influencers, God is a good God. She said, when she saw the offers, she began to roll on the floor. It's the same thing with my testimony. And I shared it with you. Don't think that God is choosy. So He's only favoring my family. If you worship in this church, and I remain this one God has placed over you as your pastor, I've always told you, whatsoever grace, and the process of modesty, whatsoever grace you've seen at work in my life, it is at work in your life. Except your service is not from your heart. And except you've chosen not to honor me or honor the grace of God upon my life, if there is anything, you know, I don't think. What I mean by that is, I don't worry about anything. I don't have anything. I get things. Before I make the request, they're available. People favor me. I told you countless number of times how every time I dress up, anytime you see me, there is something on me that I did not buy in my money. Since 2009, that didn't happen to me. As I'm dressed, let me see, this shoe is David Wedge. I didn't pay for it. Anytime you see me, this wristwatch was given also. Where's Brother Ife? Brother Ife sold this wristwatch into my life. Every time you see me, whenever you meet me, there will be something on, sometimes it's head to toe like Brother Victor. Everything, maybe just one person getting it. So if you are serving and you belong to this ministry and you connect, every breast that is available over the set man is also available in your life. If you've been serving and you are not seeing the manifestation of these things, you need to withdraw, assess yourself and ask yourself some questions. Maybe you're not doing some things rightly. That which you want to kill yourself over right now, it's nothing compared to what God has in store for you. So don't think that God is just favoring his family. The same way he is for me is the same way he's doing for you. But you must be persistent. I just told you, if she, who is my wife, can be questioning God, she questions God to me privately. Then she came to recharge, and she questioned God in service. Sister Chima, do you remember that service? God is a good God. There is nothing that can diminish that power. I want you to do something going forward. Cast your relationship with God. Do not make it transactionary. Get to that level where you say, maybe you're trusting God for money. You want to buy a house or you want to do something. Get to that level where you say to God, Father, this job, whether I get it or I do not get it, you remain God. Please, are you with me? You're trying to sit for an exam. You're preparing yourself for the exam. You're doing all you can to succeed in the exam. Get to that level where you would say to God, Father, I declare an A in this examination. I've done my best in this examination. But Lord, I just want you to know, whether I get that or I do not, I'll get job offers, as painful as it was, Sister Tolu. I'll get to my house and be rolling on the floor giving God thanks. There is a level of gratitude, a sense of gratitude that a believer must have, and that is gratitude unto God when the going is not good. It takes grace to be able to give gratitude, praise unto God when things are not good. When God has done what you want him to do, you can jump up and do all of all those things, but what if or what when it doesn't happen the way you want it to happen? God is a good God. This God is a good God. He has you, your life, inscribed on the palms of his hands. This is the place that I know, this society or this nation generally, is where people feel coming to church and serving is to serve the pastor. Don't come to church because of me. I beseech you by the mercy of the Lord. Come for relationships. Come to hear the word of the Lord. Come so that you can grow. Come such that words of prophecy can be declared over your life. Let me tell you the spiritual dimension of our testimony. After she had gone for that interview, I was praying the middle of the night on Friday, a few days before she was called. I think she was called following me. Personally, I don't have any prayer requests, personal requests. Each and every one of you here, you are my prayer request. Mentioning your names one after the other. Now we are not up to 60. So I'm still able to mention each and everybody's name. Those who are here, who belong to this church. Lord, I pray for Ken as he serves. Please favor him. Before he calls, please show up for him. And I was praying. So after I was done, I began to pray for other people. And the Holy Spirit said, laid my wife in my heart. And I said, Lord, this lady, she's been diligent. She's been serving. Please show her your mercy. Specifically, I told God, I said, show her a token of your good. That was the prayer the psalmist prayed. Lord, just show me a token of your good. And I went to bed with that prayer. That was month before then, maybe like 6 months, 7 months, or 8 months before that period, I was praying. And I was asking God. I said, why is this lady trying to live where she is right now? Despite all that she's doing, the way we serve, the way we are committed to you, and this job is not coming. And the Lord told me straight up. The Lord said to me, our motives are not right. She's my wife. This is service I can pick up now. The Lord said, our motives are not right. So I sat her down. I said, you heard that talk about motive when she got the job, when she was his friend. I said, have you asked God, have you sit down to think about why you wanted that job? Is it just to add more money? Or to just oppress people? unto God's glory. So I said, go and sort out the path that's good motives. Like, how many times would I have told you about your motives not being right? I said, go and sort out the path that has to do with your motives. God, once you sort those paths out, God is able to do for you much more than you desire. Then I would ask her, I said, have you sorted out your motive with the Lord? Then she said, yes. I said, okay, now that you have, I trust the God that I serve to surprise you soon. Surprising you soon was not the following month. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. Surprising you soon was not following on. I want you to know that when the word of the Lord has gone out, it is bound to accomplish that for which it has been sent. So he desires to give you what you desire. What about the motive? John chapter number 15, verse 7. The condition attached to getting what you want is you abiding in him and his words abiding in you. So how can you, as a believer, how can you abide in the Lord? How can you, as a believer, abide in the Lord? Walk in love. I see so many spirits of bitterness in this country. Times that I've never seen in my life. Many people are bitter. I'm not talking about being angry. I mean bitter. If you need help, please seek for help. Don't allow for any reason. You see, don't allow, I'm going to touch on this sometimes, maybe later on in the month of September or so, but I just want you to know, hold nothing against any man. It can be tough, because the reason why my life is the way it is, that's the reason why I don't have high blood pressure. When I go to bed, I sleep, I snore. Some of you have been so hurt that walking in love has become an issue. I cannot stop emphasizing the fact that you shouldn't hold nothing against anybody. Listen to me. Stop on. If I treat you shabbily, if I treat you badly, it's a reflection of who I am, not who you are. Now you guys didn't get that. If people treat you less than your worth, it's a reflection of who they are, not who you are. People can only treat you based on who they are. No man can give what he or she does not have, Sister Chidima. So if the person lambasts you, if the person abuses you, if the person ridicules you, it's a reflection of the person, not you. Walk in love. Bible says, oh, no man, nothing except love. Walk in love. Walk in love. How can you belong to the same church? I thank God we don't have any kind of that kind of people here anymore. Glory to Jesus. May they not come back in Jesus' name. Amen. When you come to church, you are choir members and you are not on talking terms. And you hold microphone. I'm not saying these microphones. One will hold this microphone, another will be on this microphone, and you are not talking to each other. And you're praying, glory, oh, God must have been merciful. If not, thunder should have struck somebody. Trust in him, number two. Trust in God. What do I mean, trusting in God? Trusting in God per second. Somebody say, trust in God per second.
Trust in God.
Lord, I don't understand, but I trust you. Lord, I don't know, but I trust you. I don't know that. Trust in the Lord. I'm teaching you, I'm taking you through a few points on how you can abide in him. Trust in him. Don't trust him only for specific things about your life. Trust him for everything. God either has all or he has none. You cannot say, Lord, I want to trust you for my finances and for my career and for my family. But you see, for my relationship with that boy or that my relationship with that girl, I don't want to trust you. That one, I'm already in love. So don't worry about that one. That one is sorted, okay? But God, my academics, my job, I'm trusting you on those. No, 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 no. He either has all or he has none. Trust in him completely. How do you do that? Every day you wake up, even if you, for any reason, maybe you'll find an hour to pray or whatever, as you get up on your bed, you say, Lord Jesus, today I roll before you. trust you because you're a good God and it is a good day for me. Seek his pleasure. You want to abide in him? Seek his pleasure. Serve the Lord. Seek his business and pursue it. I have told us countless number of times how when you find yourself, regardless if it is lofty height or any other place or whatever thing, to fight is God's house or God's project, get handy. If you've chosen to look that place of hope, look for a way to make contributions. Look for something that you can do. Seek his pleasure. The Bible says to us that we should seek first the kingdom of God, Matthew chapter number 6, verses 3, and in his righteousness, and every other thing will be added unto you. You want to abide in God? Walk in holiness. I'm not saying walk in righteousness. I'm saying walk in holiness. If I'm saying walk in righteousness, then in effect I'm saying walk in believing God. Walk in trusting God. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying walk in holiness. I told you before when I treated it, law versus righteousness, there is nothing you can do that can make you more righteous. Righteousness, the Bible says, Apostle Paul says to the church in Rome, he says, righteousness is not of work. He says, let's say man should boast. So you've been made righteous when a laborer works. The laborer earns money as a result of what he or she has done. But the righteousness that we have is not as a result of anything we've done or anything we've done. The Bible says, in that while we were yet sinners, Brother Ben, Christ loved us and gave himself up for us all. Walk in holiness. You know holiness? Holiness is Galatians chapter number 5, verse 13. Or is it verse 16? 16, God bless you, darling. Galatians chapter number 5, verse 16. Galatians 5, 16. Walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. I know I have so many of us here who are young professionals and young adults, and I cannot, you know, cease to emphasize this. Bible says every sin a man commits is against, is outside the body. Anything that you get yourself engaged in, these are the things that I do say sometimes that most of you, you know, don't like your pastor anymore, I know. But I keep saying, every sin that you do that's sexual in any form pollutes your body, which is the house, the temple of the Holy Ghost. Do you know if you murder someone, it is outside your body? Do you know that? If you lie, do you know that's outside your body? You're already looking at me like that again. I shared this sermon some time ago. Many of them didn't come to church again. Please, I want you to come, okay? I want you to come. You know, Sergei, there was a day I was in ministry. And the Lord, you know, showed me some faces. And then led me through some of the very heinous things they were doing. So I stand on the altar. I didn't face those people. I looked straight. And I kept sharing the things God told me. And I kept telling them, okay, what if I take your phone right now and I check those apps? The following Sunday, it is well. You want to abide in the Lord? Give to Kingdom's project. It's such a pleasure to see Brother Dami in church again this morning after a long while in Toronto. Welcome back to church, sir. When this man was traveling to Toronto for a course, the last time he was with us must have been Watch Night Service, December 31st. This same, not this room, but this same hotel. His television set, he gave it to church as a seed. You see, I want more, I want more, I want more. It's the reason why many people are not blessed. When you want your heart, you see this TV here. This is not church property. This is flower. Belongs to Brother Ifeo, Brother Sam. I'm not too sure who exactly. Prior to that period, this guy here, Brother Ken, will carry his own television set to come to church. This small TV here, Brother Daniel Ludero, gifted it to the church. I cannot count. So I give God thanks for the kind of people who are here. I'm just saying, you can do better. You can do better. I was telling those who were with us last night, if you spend all that you earn on yourself alone, you're of all men most miserable. You don't tithe, you don't give offering. Let's say you don't believe in any of those ones. Or let's say, oh, Pastor, that Pastor Tenju likes good things. So he's going to use my money to buy bracelets, or he's going to use it to buy another shoe. Okay, keep your money in your pocket. What about those that are in the streets who need something to feed? What about foundations? Foundations that cater for maybe the old age people or the children? I'm going to share a sermon on that maybe next week Sunday. I do not know yet. What about abiding in his word? Let's go to the second part. How do you abide in the word of the Lord? Hearing the word the way you're doing right now. Romans chapter number 10, verse 17. It says, faith therefore comes by hearing. Hearing what? The word of the Lord. You want to abide. You want the word of the Lord to abide in you. Hear the word of the Lord. That's why I keep saying, please don't miss church. You are even so blessed. Why? Because this church service is just for 90 minutes. Oh. 90 minutes. When I was like, some of you here, you know, still under the tutelage of my parent, when we go to church as early as 7 a.m. or 8 a.m., we don't come back until 3 p.m. I'm not kidding you. Because our praying to be done, then they will be moving from one meeting to another, meeting to another meeting, and you have to wait. They will say, come, 10 a.m., 11:30 a.m., we are done. If for any reason you're delayed, maybe till 10:40, it's become an issue. You say, why are you not in church? Say, I slept off. Why are you not in church? Because I'm working at 11:30. Even if you're working at 11:30, you can just step in, hear the word. Especially for a ministry as this, where the Lord sends us his word. It may be that statement that you will hear that will transform your life. Okay, you were not in church because you had some things doing. Beautiful. Maybe you had to go to work. Awesome. But we also post sermons on YouTube. You did not attend that service. Have you been blessed by YouTube? You will not say God is not good. Because the words that you should hear that will cause you to abide in the Lord and the Lord abide in you, you're not hearing them. You're not. And in bringing the service to a close this morning, I'll go back to that John chapter number 15. John chapter number 15, verses 4. I want to lay emphasis on the bear much fruit. God bless you, Brother Victor. I want to lay emphasis on the bear much fruit part of it. You see, this scripture, Jesus was only having an exchange with his disciples. And I want you to know that if you've given your life to Jesus, according to Galatians chapter number 2, verse 20, I told you before, you cannot claim to have been crucified with Christ, yet still be conscious of self. Did you hear me? So, I've been crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. The life that I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loves me and who gave himself up to me. So, if indeed you've been crucified with Christ, then let your actions and your inaction, let me speak of that crucifixion. So when you say you've been crucified with Christ, you're simply saying, I'm no longer conscious of self. It is no longer about me, what I can do or what I cannot do. It's about God. What am I saying? I'm telling you this morning that you are not the vine. You are a branch out of the vine. To bring it home closer, you are not the tree. You are a branch of a tree. That tree remains Jesus. Bible says that the any part of the branch that is not bearing fruit, it says it will cut off. Matthew chapter number 5 from verses number 13 to 16 tells us, it says you are the salt of the earth. It says when the salt loses its flavor, it says of what use will it be? It says it has nothing other than to be thrown on the floor and to be trampled upon by men. May you not be trampled upon. May you not be trampled upon. So you are not a vine, you are not the tree, you are a branch. The part that I saw here that struck me the most is that part of Jesus saying in John chapter number 15 that we read earlier, that you bear much fruit. In other words, when you go on your own, you may bear fruit, but with Jesus, you bear much fruit. So would you rather bear fruit or bear much fruit? I'm the vine. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Matthew chapter number 7, which we read at the start of the service. Matthew chapter number 7:7-11. If you read, if you have the Amplified version of that scripture, or try NIV, I know we don't have Amplified. Try NIV or NLT. Give me NLT. Let's see what NLT says. Is this NLT? Okay, beautiful. Now, Matthew 7:7, I've preached on this too before, but I just want to lay emphasis on it as I bring the service to close. Ask, you will be given. Seek, you will find. Knock, the door will open. Right? Do you know what the original translation of that verse says? It's that you should keep on asking and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking, keep on knocking. Amplified version is what I love the most. Matthew chapter number 7. Let me read what Amplified version says to you. Amplified version says, ask and keep on asking and it will be given to you. It says, seek and keep on seeking and you will find. Knock and keep on knocking and the door will open to you. Why am I reading this? It's for the one who has prayed once and says, God is not a good God. God did not hear me. So I'm going to shut my mouth. Is somebody in God's presence? Somebody in God's presence? So this is for someone who says, why do I have to pray so hard for that particular thing before it comes? This was Jesus. Not just to ask, but to keep on asking. The path of faith is there. But you see, you will not stop asking, seeking, knocking, finding until your eyes begin to behold what your mouth is saying. So you say, when will I now stop praying? Maybe you're trusting God for the fruit of the womb, for instance. You continue to pray for your baby. Declare over the baby's life until the baby is delivered into your hands physically. You know the part that I love the most here? This version says that, verse 8, let me see what your verse 8 looks like. Beautiful. For everyone who asks, receives. Let me do Amplified. Amplified says, for everyone who keeps on asking, receives. Not everyone who asks. Everyone who keeps on asking, receives. And he who keeps on seeking, finds. And to him who keeps on knocking, it will be open unto you. God is a good God. There is no unrighteousness. There is no iniquity. There is nothing of such in Jesus. There is nothing of such in Jesus. If your motive is right, and that which you desire is good for you, he desires to give you your desire much more than you desire to have your desire. Rise up on your feet this morning. I'd just like you to just talk to God and say, Lord, I believe, I declare and I confess that you're a good God. Give God thanks for being a good God. There is no bad mood in him. He is perpetually in good moods. Open your mouth and just give him thanks. Lord, I thank you this morning because you are a good God. You're a good God. Can you give me on the keyboard if you may?
You're a good, good God. To you.
You're a good God. You're a good God. You're a good God. No righteousness in you. Give him thanks this morning. Maybe you've never even said it to him before that he's good. God, I thank you because you're a good God. You're a good God. You are a good God. If you are here new in the city, especially for those of you who are students, Brother Tonoa and Brother Oriola, please declare unto God this morning, God, you are a good God. You brought me to this city for a purpose. You are a good Father. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. No matter how much the devil tries, I will not let him tell me that you are not good. You are a good God. You are a good God. God, you are a good God. You are precious. Thank you for being so good. Thank you for being so good. Thank you, Jesus, for being so good. Thank you, Jesus, for being so good. God is a good God. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. At Lofty Height, we don't like bringing our services to a close without giving someone an opportunity to have a relationship with this God who is good. All that I've shared, the testimony you heard, and many things God is doing in this home, it may seem to you like something that cannot be replicated in your life. But I want you to know this morning that if you would do, if you would believe God, He's able to do for you even much more than He has done for others. Bible says in John chapter number 15, verse 7, abide in me, and my word abide in you. Then you can ask me whatsoever thing you desire, and I can give it to you. Is there someone under the sound of my voice this morning? You don't have a relationship with God. You've not accepted Him as the Lord of your life, but you want Him to become the Lord of your life this morning. I like you without shame. Just signify by the raising up of your hand. If there is anybody like that, Bible says that you can, with me, you can do nothing. Maybe certainly you've been trying on your own to do things, but it's not been working. Is somebody willing to yield unto God this morning? I'm not saved. Jesus saved me. Or I used to be saved. I've gone back into the world. But I desire this relationship again. Anyone like that this morning? If there is not, can we please stand my hands together with Jesus? Come on and celebrate Jesus. If you receive that word that has come to you this morning, celebrate Jesus. I'd like you to just give someone a high five and say, God is a good God. And He's always in a good mood. God is a good God. And He's always in a good mood. God is a good God. And He's always in a good mood. Have your seat in God's presence this morning. Amen. Glory to Jesus.